Hello and welcome to this tutorial series, Pulling the Perfect Key in DaVinci Resolve. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. And in this short tutorial series, we're going to be looking at how we pull the perfect key using Primatte Studio. And over the next few videos, I'm going to be taking you through my checklist and how I approach a green screen key. And we're going to break this down into several steps, including the primary key, the importance of spill suppression, hold in and hold out mats, doing our primary color balance, creating matching effect for the background, and then tying it all together with some finishing touches. And we're not just going to be learning about Boris's Primatte Studio, I'm also going to be taking you through some little workflow tips and tricks for working in Resolve itself. So without any further ado, let's start off with our shot. And the first thing I always do is actually play the shot back and just try to identify any potential problems that we're going to have with it. And straight away, I can see that there's a few issues with this particular piece of footage. It's not bad, but we have some troubling areas. To begin with, we have fine hair details. That's always a bit tricky. So we're going to have to try and worry about keeping those in as we go. The next thing is, well, actually probably the biggest thing that I can see from now is having an uneven green screen. So we don't have a nice flat single color that we're going to have to pull a key from. We've actually got a few different tones in here as well. The next thing to notice about the background is that the actual background doesn't extend all the way to the edges. We've got a little bit of a gap here. That's not too bad. That's fine. And if we play the clip through a little bit, we can see that we do also have, if we look at the sword here, we have a reflection of the green screen in the sword as well. So that could cause us a few issues later. So with this in mind, let's see how we start up our keying process. Now in Resolve, we can be applying effects either in the edit room, where we are now. And as you can see, I have my list of filters all here, including Primatte Studio, which we're going to be looking for in the keying. But as of Resolve 16, we can't be applying effects that create an alpha channel in the edit page, in the edit room. But just so you're aware of how I've got my clip set up at the moment, I've got my background on video track one, which is just a still frame taken from a longer clip. And I've got my green screen over the top on video track two. Let's pop in to the color room. And I've got my timeline turned on because I want to make sure that I am actually selecting the top clip, the clip that's on video track two, and I am. So let's open up the nodes. I'm not going to do any color correction on the first node, but I want to have that opportunity to come back and do something to it later. So the first thing I'm going to do is actually come in and add a new serial node. And this is the one that I'm going to add my Primatte to. So if I give this a node label, I'm going to call this one Primatte Studio. And I'll come in to open up my open effects. I'll just tap in Primatte, misspelled, of course. Just having that in the search option gives me enough information to grab the filter and put it over the top. Now, just so that I've got a bit more space, I'm going to turn my nodes off again. And with the Boris FX Primatte Studio, we have a UI that lets us do much of the work without even touching the settings on the right-hand side. And this is very important because there are a lot of settings that we can be working with in Primatte Studio. It's not just a simple color here, we can do a whole lot more with it. And coming over to the UI, we can move this around just by clicking and dragging anywhere inside of it. And I'll just place it over on the right-hand side here. And it's set up so that generally speaking, we start from the top and work our way downwards. So the first thing to do is click on Auto Analyze. And this makes Primatte Studio have a little look at our footage and guess what color we want to key out. If we want a blue screen or a green screen, it's going to make a decent guess right from the get-go. If that's not working, we can always click on the manual sample background there and then just click in the viewer anywhere here. But despite appearances, I'm actually happy with how things are right now. But you've got to admit, it looks a bit of a mess. And again, this is because of the way that Resolve handles alpha channels. I'm going to open my nodes up And anywhere in the blank area of the node tree, I'm going to just right click and go add alpha output. This gives me a little dot that I can now pipe the alpha channel from my Primatte Studio into, but still nothing's changed. So we have to do one last thing, and that's tell Resolve that we want to use the alpha channel from the OFX plugin. So I'm going to right click on my Primatte Studio node and go use OFX alpha. And now, as if by magic, our clip is looking a lot better placed. And if I play that back, you can see it's not perfect yet. Not by far. You know, we can still see some of the stripes of the background there, but it's actually shaping up into something. At least we can see our forest in the background. Okay, so let's work down this UI. We have two buttons here that say point and rect for rectangle, and these control how we sample the rest of Primatte Studio's tools. So I want to clean up the background. So with clean background selected, I can just click and drag. You see, because I've got point turned on, that Primatte Studio draws a point where my mouse cursor has gone. And if I lift the button, it will then clean up the background. So far, so good. But I want to show another little trick to get you a better key from the get-go. And that's not to look at it in the final composite mode, or even the final matte mode, which lets us see the alpha channel. Instead, let's have a look at the matte status mode. And because I'm done with the nodes again, I'm just going to hide those nodes so that we've got a bit more space for our viewer. So looking back at this slightly larger viewer now, we've got three colors in the matte status. We have white, where everything is completely opaque, so the pixel is completely opaque. We have black, where the pixel is completely transparent. We have gray, where the pixel is neither completely transparent or completely opaque. So this helps us look for areas on the image, on the background, where I might need to just draw a little bit more to clean that background up. Maybe a little bit there. So the great thing about matte status is that some of these pixels might be almost transparent, but not quite, and sort of fool us into thinking that it's a perfect key. With the matte status, there's no hiding. Now, looking at this now, I also want to clear up what's happening with the shield and maybe some of the bits that's happening inside the face as well. And for this, I need to clean the foreground. I'm also going to change my sample from point to rectangle, just so I can show you what's going on there. So if I click and drag with the rectangle, Primatte Studio is actually going to sample all of the stuff within that rectangle and then use those values to help clean the foreground. Excellent. So I'm going to play this through just to see if I'm missing anything big. And you can see we've got a few bits on the sword here. But we know from when we looked back at the shot to begin with that this is probably reflections. So I'm fine with that. We've got a little bit on the face there and there. Maybe a few pixels there. So I might come in and just draw over those a little bit. Just see if I can clean those up. And I've got a little bit over here as well. So I'll just clean that up there. I can also see underneath the hand, I need to clean up a bit more of the background color. We'll just take that just a little bit here. Now, I don't want to be too aggressive at this time because I want to keep in a lot of this hair detail. And over the course of this series, I'm going to be paying particular attention to the hair. And the reason for that is that hair and other fine details are some of the most difficult things that you're going to get to key. And it's also what helps to make or break the composite. So if you've got horrible spider legs instead of hair, that's going to be a dead giveaway. But for now, I'm pretty happy, I think. I'm going to have a look at my final matte. Yep, I can see that I've got a good amount of hair detail still in here. Zoom out a little bit there. Play that through. That's looking quite nice. Generally speaking, my subject is looking pretty good. I've got a little bit of the reflection that we were talking about earlier, and I've got a little bit of stuff still happening in the background. But if I look at the final composite, but basically doing four clicks that probably would have taken about 20 seconds to do real time, it's not looking too bad. My goal here is to get a good base for us to build on with the next few steps. So at this stage, I don't want to be too aggressive and try to clean up, you know, more background here, undo that, or come in too close and get every single little detail fixed with one click. That's just not going to happen. We've got a decent looking primary mat. We've got our node set up correctly, and we're ready to continue. And in the next exercise, we're going to be looking in more detail at the hair and the importance of spill suppression. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris FX, and I look forward to seeing you again in part two of Pulling the Perfect Key in DaVinci Resolve. If you're enjoying it so far, please remember to hit the like button before you watch the next video. You can also subscribe for more videos by hitting the big button there. If you've got any comments, questions, or you just want to tell a terrible joke, then leave that in the comments section. If you want to follow along with this, use the download link in the description.